The early 1900s brought radical change to America. Traditional ways of doing things and thinking about things gave way to new ideas and attitudes, some of which would prove a challenge to traditional values, the family structure, and common beliefs about morality. There were changes in fashion, music, art, architecture, and everyday life, with new inventions such as the automobile, the telephone, silent movies, and the airplane, and new ideas of freedom for women. In the workplace, women of the period had faced unequal pay and unequal employment opportunities, as well as unequal opportunities in education, making it even harder for women to better themselves. No longer content to live with these inequalities, women sought change. They became more active and assertive, and more vocal, demanding an end to what they saw as society's ills. A group of social reformers, known as progressives, claimed they could fix society's problems by making the masses conform to what they believed was for the good of society, even if it meant taking control over ordinary people's lives, their actions, choices, and decisions. And one such progressive thought she had the answer to the problems facing women. This was Margaret Sanger. In keeping with progressive thought, Sanger's plan called for control of the masses for the betterment of society. But her solution for women seemed, to some, not a way to help them rise above their circumstances or improve their self-esteem, but rather one that would turn individual liberty, the family structure, public morals, and the value of human life itself completely upside down. Margaret Higgins Sanger was born in 1879 to a family of 11 children. Sanger's mother was Catholic, but her father demanded that the family not practice the faith. And while Margaret's mother tried to teach the children their faith secretly, her early death left them without any real religious influence. Sanger mistakenly believed her mother's death was due to having too many children. In fact, it was tuberculosis that took her mother's life. But this mistaken belief may have formed Sanger's attitudes about childbearing for the rest of her life. As an adult, Sanger enrolled in nursing school, dropping out before finishing her degree to get married. But though she hadn't completed her nursing education, she soon took a job as a self-described nurse working in the slums of New York City. There, she witnessed great suffering and poverty. Certainly, there were many causes of the suffering she encountered, but Sanger believed the main cause of the sorry plight of the poor was simply women having too many babies. In fact, Sanger believed some women should not be allowed to have any children at all. And so she determined that preventing pregnancy was the solution, not only for these women, but also for society as a whole. Sanger believed that birth control, using birth control as her plan directed, families would be limited to 2 or 3 children. After all, to Sanger, having more than 3 children per family was irresponsible. Margaret Sanger would go on in her lifetime mistakenly promoting birth control and the restriction of the number of children per family as the solution to most of the problems facing women and society in general. However, as we shall see, she didn't stop there.
The most merciful thing that the large family does to one of its infant members is to kill it.
Margaret Sanger from Woman and the New Race, 1920.
While I personally believe in the sterilization of the feeble-minded, the insane, and the syphilitic, I have not been able to discover that these measures are more than superficial deterrents when applied to the constantly growing stream of the unfit. Margaret Sanger, Birth Control and Racial Betterment, The Birth Control Review, February 1919.
Margaret Sanger promoted birth control as what she believed was a social good because she believed that bringing fewer children into the world would improve the lives of women and the quality of society. For this, many women today admire her, mistakenly believing her. Her belief in reducing births morphed into a new, more frightening theory. Now, according to Sanger, only certain women from certain backgrounds should be allowed to bear children at all. Because, she believed, the disabled, the intellectually challenged, and the mentally handicapped would only lead to the decline of society. Don't believe me? Here's what Sanger wrote in The Eugenic Value of Birth Control Propaganda, Birth Control Review, October 1921.
The most urgent problem today is how to limit and discourage the overfertility of the mentally and physically defective. Margaret Sanger.
Sanger and others like her believed that with birth control, citizens could make and live in a near-perfect society, cleansed of the poor, the unintelligent, the mentally disabled, the physically unattractive, the racially inferior, as she determined, and others she deemed unfit. This, she thought, would make society a better place. If Margaret Sanger were alive today, she most surely would believe that if you, for example, do not meet these criteria, you are not really fit to live, and certainly not fit to reproduce. Without these traits, your birth would have been a mistake. More importantly, you must not be allowed to continue that mistake by having children. By doing so, she would argue, you hinder human progress. Do you think you would make the cut? Would you be allowed to have children? What about your parents? Would they have been allowed to have you? Stop for a second and think about this. It sounds bizarre. Actually, it sounds frightening. Yet the truth is that there were, in Margaret Sanger's time and are today, people who believe in the forced sterilization of certain groups of people. Sanger was very familiar with a quasi-science called eugenics. Simply defined, eugenics is the controlled reproduction of the right kind of people. Sanger, among many other noted progressives, thought that the use of eugenics would improve the human race. In Germany, eugenics laid the foundation for one of the worst holocausts in history, the execution of millions of Jews for the sake of creating a better society. Sadly, and maybe news for Americans today, these ideas did not belong solely to the Nazis. Sanger treated pregnancy as a disease, a problem, and an abnormality. She believed that pregnancy causes hunger, divorce, crime, murder, war, plagues, and every other problem on the face of the earth. She did not understand or believe that every person is valuable and should be loved, cherished, and welcomed. Further, she believed that the unchecked reproduction of, quote, morons, mental defectives, and epileptics, unquote, would overrun America. And for her, sterilization of just the feeble-minded was not enough. She thought birth control might also be used to eliminate the poor in society. Sanger argued that poor and sick women should stop, in her words, polluting the public gene pool. To Sanger, liberating women from childbearing through birth control was the only way to prevent the birth of unwanted people. Her solution to the challenge of making a woman's life better? Eliminate certain people, certain types of people, certain groups of people. How many of us would be here if Sanger had had anything to say about it? Did our parents have enough money, power, and education to satisfy Sanger's theories for them to have children? Sanger slowly won over much of the American public to her ideas of what she termed birth control. And when Sanger would capture the support of the American public, her campaign for contraception was sure to succeed. What do you get when you combine an unplanned pregnancy with the contraceptive mindset Sanger advocated? There was, and still is, one answer: ending a human life in the form of abortion. Remember, Sanger did not just advocate for contraception, but for birth control, which includes abortion. The next and final video in this series will examine what Margaret Sanger hath wrought, her legacy of societal regression, and how it impacts us and our lives, even today.
I accepted an invitation to talk to the women's branch of the Ku Klux Klan. I saw through the door dim figures parading with banners and illuminated crosses. I was escorted to the platform, was introduced, and began to speak. In the end, through multiple illustrations, I believed I had accomplished my purpose. A dozen invitations to speak to similar groups were proffered. Margaret Sanger, an autobiography, page 366. No woman shall have the legal right to bear a child, and no man shall have the right to become a father without a permit. Margaret Sanger, from America Needs a Code for Babies, published in 1934.
Wanting her message to appeal to the middle class, Sanger realized that she needed a different public image from that of a radical socialist woman. So in 1922, Sanger left her first husband and married the rich and elderly J. Noah Slee, who eagerly financed her projects. Sanger and her second husband lived in an immoral, open marriage filled with extramarital affairs. When it came to human sexuality, Sanger didn't want people, married or unmarried, to deny themselves. She felt that unmarried women should not abstain from sexual activity, a mindset that leaves women open to abuse, disrespect, and moral ruin. Chastity, to her, was an outdated virtue. To indoctrinate others, Sanger wrote a series of articles called What Every Girl Should Know, explaining that girls should know how to prevent babies through contraception. Public interest in the birth control movement began to grow dramatically because of her persistence and her advocacy. But despite Sanger's attempt to change her image, her new marriage only led to estrangement from her own children. During this time, Sanger founded an organization called the American Birth Control League, which evolved into the Planned Parenthood Federation of America. Abortion was a radical idea for Sanger and other feminists to advocate in the early 20th century, so she focused on birth control. But if birth control only prevents the unfit from being created, what do you do with an unfit person who has already been created? Abortion was the next logical step if birth control failed or wasn't used. Sanger knew where her beliefs would take society, and she knew what would eventually happen when children were depicted as burdens rather than blessings. Once you believe that children are a burden, what do you do with an unwanted pregnancy? According to Sanger's plan, abortion is the only choice left. Margaret Sanger died September 6, 1966, but her eugenic policies did not die with her. Sterilizations, targeted contraceptive use, and racial targeting with abortion have only increased. Margaret Sanger may no longer be alive, but her ideas are still being used to decide the fate of millions. Today, we face even more problems because of Sanger's philosophies, influence, and the programs she created. STDs are on the rise. Many single moms don't get help from society, and women suffer from disrespect and domestic violence. Margaret Sanger's organization, Planned Parenthood, has become the largest abortion chain in the United States, killing over 6.63 million American babies from 1970 to 2013. These numbers increase every year. With abortion on demand, racial targeting has become easier for eugenicists, those so-called societal engineers who have devalued human life for the sake of a controlled humanity. Today, because of the pressure put on them by society, Black and Hispanic women are much more likely to abort their children than white women. Even after birth control and classroom sex education, sexual promiscuity has only increased. An estimated 3.2 million teen girls have had at least one sexually transmitted disease. The culture and its messaging tells us that this is freedom, when, in reality, it can be devastating. In his letter to women on June 29, 1995, St. John Paul II eloquently described the problem for women and recognized the need for change that upholds women's fertility as a gift, not as a curse.
What shall we say of the obstacles which in so many parts of the world still keep women from being fully integrated into social, political, and economic life? We need only think of how the gift of motherhood is often penalized rather than rewarded. Even though humanity owes its very survival to this gift, certainly, much remains to be done to prevent discrimination against those who have chosen to be wives and mothers. As far as personal rights are concerned, there is an urgent need to achieve real equality in every area. Equal pay for equal work, protection for working mothers, fairness in career advancements, equality of spouses with regard to family rights, and the recognition of everything that is part of the rights and duties of citizens in a democratic state.
We must learn to recognize the gifts of both men and women and the different but equally important roles that each brings to society. Women with surprise pregnancies may need help, but they don't need to defeat their fertility and their natural biology in order to be equal to men. The ability to have babies should be seen as a great gift, not a drawback. Remember that Margaret Sanger was just one woman. However, her determination made an indelible impact on the world, on each of you. She mistakenly believed that children were the cause of society's problems, and she was determined to change the mindset of people. This was not easy, and it took her a very long time. 50 years passed from the time she began advocating for birth control to the time the birth control pill was legalized. Sanger used her passion and determination to reach a goal that was sinister at best. Imagine the good you could do if you applied passion and determination to build a culture of life. We all know someone who is going through, or who has gone through, a difficult time in life. Maybe he's the new kid in school. Maybe her parents just got divorced. Maybe he's being bullied. Maybe she's lost a sibling. Or maybe he's suffering from some kind of illness. Often people suffer silently, unsure how to open up to others. One of the most important things you can do every day to live a pro-life life is to be a friend, to be a positive influence on others and to show you care. How you treat people can make a huge difference in their lives. A kind word, a friendly conversation, even just a simple smile can help someone in ways beyond your imagination. Where will doing nothing leave that person? Think about what may have happened had someone taken a young Margaret Sanger under his wing and comforted her in her time of loss. Or if someone had been there as a moral compass, a guide to show her the value of all life. How might things have been different? How can you make a difference? What else does this sad and lost world need from you? 1. Pray to end abortion. 2. Keep yourself up to date on issues that threaten the culture of life. Abortion, euthanasia, contraception, cohabitation, etc. 3. Practice chastity and abstinence. Save yourself for your future spouse. 4. Treat men and women with equal dignity and respect. 5. Be a good influence to others. Today in our culture, and even among your peers, it takes courage to live as a pro-life believer. If you don't, who will?